Good evening. I'm Lew Goldstein, and welcome to Open Source. Open Source will be a weekly show that's dedicated to discussions about politics nationally and in our state. And tonight, I'm very fortunate to have on the show Lisa Durden, who is the Green Party Lieutenant Governor candidate running in November. And Lisa, thank you so much for coming on.
No, thank you for giving us some fair coverage. It's hard out here in these streets.
Well, we've invited both major candidates to come on, and you were the first ones to appear. So I'm very happy that
we can use
this time, you know, wisely and talk about some of the issues that are facing New Jersey today. Mm-hmm. But before we get into that, maybe we can talk a little bit about your background so people get to know you and know a little bit about Lisa Durden.
Well, I like to think I'm a celebrity, but of course it's all in my head. Before this life called politics, I, for a living, am a media expert. I'm a TV show host and TV personality. I have my own local show called The Lisa Durden Show.
Okay.
Tried to be creative. It's online now too, but it's we shoot in Newark. And then from there, over the years, I became a producer. So my career went from being on camera to behind the camera because I also felt like those images that people of color don't like on television can't be changed unless we change them. So I started to produce documentaries initially, but now I produce feature films and I direct as well. I don't only do produce and direct topics or issues around people of color or marginalized folks. You know, it can be some fun stuff too, but definitely I don't shy away from those things. And so over the years, because of my career as a media expert, I've been invited to be on appear on other people's shows as a political commentator, a pop culture commentator. I've written for many publications in the same vein, in the area of pop culture, politics, and social issues. So I'm always on Pix 11, Dr. Oz, Fox, for the good or the bad. And so I also do those things to keep my brand fresh and popping.
Good. Well, I see one of the interesting things moving from that into the political atmosphere.
Jesus!
I think one of the interesting things, though, is had you come to become on the ticket with Seth as his lieutenant governor?
Pretty much kicking and screaming.
Okay.
But, well, I don't know if anybody knows. I was invited to appear on a Fox show called Tucker Carlson Tonight. Okay. I had been on Fox now as a commentator for about 2 years on the Megyn Kelly show, The Kelly Files, and Fox and Friends a million times as well. The first time I've ever been on the Tucker Carlson show was sometime like June 6th of 2017, so about a couple of months ago. And so I went on Tucker Carlson show to have a conversation about Black Lives Matters, what they call their Memorial Day celebration, where they decided to have what you call an intentional safe space with only people of color to celebrate us. And so they invited them to come on to talk about it because, you know, the twist on Fox is always, it's racist, it's separatist, and you... When racists call black folks racist for calling out racism, it always makes me laugh. So they turned down the opportunity to come on the show.
Yeah.
But since they asked me, I thought I can come on the show and speak about it as an expert, which I am an expert in matters of race because I'm black, but I'm also well-versed. So I thought I could be there as an expert and speak about it from the sidelines in a way because I'm not a member of Black Lives Matter officially, because it began as a hashtag, and then it now moved more into an organization. But certainly I'm African-American, and I'm able to discuss it. So I went on the show normally, like I do, and it was like a six-minute segment, and I didn't know the format of the show other than he's the host. I didn't watch the show as much, and we're split screen, and the whole 6 minutes, we're having our banter, as one would call it, but, you know, others might call it something else.
Right.
And I had my talking points, and I tore into that, and I said things like, white privilege card, and you want to use your white privilege card to get into a private party. It's not something that was in a public setting, a public building,
right,
a public school. If I have a private party for my child and I don't want the bully kid coming, you can't come. Doesn't mean I don't like kids. I don't want your kid to come. So they had a right to that, even though you didn't like it. So I kind of defended their right to do it. And so it was seen over, I'm out of there. You know, I said things like white privilege card, which white privilege is real. And he was asking me questions like, you know, oh, suppose we had a white day. I said, you have white day every day. And I talked about examples of white day every day, which he was the one that asked the question. And I talked about how Oscar's so white, that hashtag. I talked about how, you know, we have movies where there's all white casts and TV shows, and it took 11 years to get a white bachelorette. So I was bringing those items up to show that this is a real thing. Racism is a real thing. white privilege is a real thing. And so we need to replace, as African-Americans, if we so choose to, right. to gather where we feel comfortable. I don't do that because I could care less one way or the other, but I'm not Black Lives Matter. So then that whole thing went viral. It went okay. 17 million views hit that video. Mm-hmm. And so, of course, I got racist trolls. And interestingly enough, 2 days after my appearance, I'm fired, well, suspended. But you know, when Black folks get suspended, that equals fire. You've worked in HR. When we get suspended, we're fired. You know, it's like a thing where when white folks get a cold, we have the flu. So I was suspended for my appearance, and then about 3 weeks later, fired. Now, I don't know what the reason was. Maybe some white supremacist complaint. I really don't know. So I was a professor at the college. My first time being a professor there the spring of 2017. And then this happened literally 2 minutes later after appearing. I was teaching a summer session called Effective Speech. So when now it became a bigger issue because my firing became a big thing globally, mm-hmm. nationally. That went viral because I'm a media personality. And now people are saying this girl had free speech. She didn't say anything hateful. She didn't scream, you know, in a crowded, you know, movie theater, fire. She did nothing wrong. So now that became a bigger conversation about the right to free speech. So some kind of way, you know, the Green Party candidate, Seth Kaper-Dale, saw this and thought, this is my lieutenant governor because she stands for what the Green Party stands for, the rights of marginalized people, the last or first, and social justice. So that's how the conversation began. They found me. I didn't find them.
So let's talk about the Green Party.
You
touched on about what the Green Party stands for.
Yes.
What are some of the basic tenets of the Green Party and the platform that you're running on this year?
Yeah. Well, the basic tenets is social justice. The Green Party's been around since the 80s. Mm-hmm. I wasn't familiar with them at that time. Right. I've been familiar with them in the last few years, just on the fringe. But social justice in all ways, in terms of immigration, rights, women's rights, rights of marginalized people, Black and brown people, right. in all those areas like Black Lives Matter, right. and those things that we discuss a lot, but people, it's tough conversation. So the Green Party's tenets pretty much wrap around anything that relates to social issues, especially when it relates to marginalized people. And so the platform we have as the Green Party candidates is the last or first. So as the lieutenant governor, when I was approached by Seth, I kind of said no for many reasons. I don't want to be in politics. I don't like politicians. I don't like politics. I mean, I vote because my four mothers and four fathers died for me to have that right. But I do it just out of the sheer right to do it. But I was disenfranchised to me by the duopoly, the Republican Democratic Party thing, and they all look alike to me. It's the lines are blurred. They are in the same pot of soup, and so I became a little, you know, desensitized. Right. So when they approached me, I said no, and then we had more conversations. I said no, and they gave me different reasons. I said no because I didn't want to put my number in the hat to be a person that I despise, which is a politician. But when I wrapped my brain around the ultimate reason why the Green Party exists is what I've been doing all along. I've been a leader all along. So I'm not really a politician, I'm a leader.
Okay.
I'm running for something called a political office so that now this voice I've been having, my voice is my activism. I've been doing for years in my writing as a blogger, in my appearances, in my documentaries. All of the content I create has had a healthy dose of this kind of social justice angle to it. So it's just an extension of what I've been doing for 15 or more years. So it didn't seem to me like I was being a politician. So when I thought about myself, I said, okay, I can do this. And as a lieutenant governor, I will do what Seth says and we win. Okay. But also, this is a new office. About 8 years we've had a lieutenant governor in the state. Mm-hmm. So they're still kind of forming it and shaping it so that we would be crafting things around my voice when I become lieutenant governor that would feed what I've been doing all along, that would help the least of us. So the last or first. So like a bottom-up approach, you know what I mean? So we've got to make sure that people are last, people of color, women, children, marginalized people, get those breaks and considerations so they can have opportunities to thrive and not survive. If you look up the word survive in the dictionary, right. y'all knock it out. All of the words you see are painful. When you look at the word, the definition of the word survive, when you look at the word thrive, just reading the definition, you start to soak in a bath and you see bubbles coming up and it's like, oh. So we want people to thrive. It gives you energy. You feel like your soul is taken care of. So that's the only reason why I decided to accept Seth's offer to be his running mate as lieutenant governor, because okay. it's something I've been doing.
Okay. Well, as we know, survival is no index of excellence, but yes. thriving is.
Yes.
Thriving is, right?
Absolutely.
So I think one of the things that I want to talk to you about is there are a lot of concerns that, you know, residents of the state of New Jersey have. Mm-hmm. And maybe we can talk, you know, briefly about some of those topics. Mm-hmm. I know a lot of times when people are looking at their taxes and they're saying, oh my gosh,
me too. You
know, I can't afford to live here anymore. I got to move somewhere else. The property taxes are so high. Mm-hmm. You know, my grandchildren won't be able to afford mm-hmm. it. I can't afford. What are we going to do, you know, realistically? How can we best approach it as collectively mm-hmm. to make property taxes something that's realistic and affordable mm-hmm. in the state of New Jersey so people aren't moving to other states?
Yeah, and so that's a huge concern. One of the many things we're thinking of doing, and this is just kind of like something we can do immediately, is giving every citizen in the state of New Jersey single-payer health care. The majority of our property taxes goes into health care. All municipalities offer their employees health care. They pay their portion, and the employee pays their portion. Most of that money that they pay comes from your property taxes.
Right.
And so if we had single-payer health care, there's no more reason for the state to pay these private companies to give the municipal workers health care. And that's where the savings comes into your property taxes. I think it's around 19%. It would be reduced to something small, like, you know, the state would have to pay, like, let's say 6%, and we pay 2%.
Right.
That's a huge reduction. That's for starters. So there would be an immediate reconciliation of property taxes just with the single-payer health care being enacted.
Okay.
That's huge. And that means everybody gets health care. And for those folks who are the least of us, the question is asked, well, you know, Seth, we use different terminology. You can say single-payer Medicare, single-payer health care. If you say, people say, we already have Medicare. Well, yeah, we do. But there is a qualification for that, and there's an age thing for that, and there's, you know, paperwork for that. Mm-hmm. This is called no paperwork, no application, no age requirement. There's no requirement other than you live in the state of New Jersey and you get health care. Everyone gets it. Even people who don't work for municipalities, it's almost like you're being double hit.
Right.
You pay high property taxes because you're paying for their insurance, and then you work at a private company, you might work at a private company, and you contribute to your own health care there.
That's correct.
Even when people work for a private organization, and now everyone gets health care and you live in the state of New Jersey, the company is no longer having to pay private companies to give you health care. They might be a little bit more friendly to now make the $15 an hour minimum wage.
Yeah.
So it's all connected. It's all interconnected.
Okay. So how do we get individuals to let's talk about the minimum wage. Should the minimum wage be raised?
Not should, it will.
Okay.
I sound like a politician. Here you go. You know, the dumb little thumb.
Right.
No, it will. Yeah. And here's what I say to people all the time. Let's be real here. I said thrive, right? Not survive.
Yeah.
$15 an hour is not a living wage. Before taxes, are you serious? That's not a living wage. But if that's the start, then maybe, I think it's 8 and change now, I haven't kept up. So the 8 and change minimum wage, think about somebody that makes that. I don't know where you might be working. I don't know. Burger King, whatever. Healthcare workers. So you start at $8 and change an hour, and then you get 2 or 3 raises, and you might get to 15. You're still broke as hell.
Right.
If you start at 15 an hour, which is still not a living wage, and you get 2 or 3 raises, then you might be at 20-something.
Right.
Now we're having a good conversation.
So graduating it in.
So it helps the trajectory of you leaving out of poverty.
Right.
So we're all about the last to first, and most people are poor in the state of New Jersey, not rich or middle class.
Right.
But it doesn't mean that we're going to abandon the middle class. We're going to save the middle class, because guess what? They're squeezing the middle class right down here. So if we are all doing well here, it's going to be a spring upwards. So you're going to be able to not worry about, will my grandkids lose the house just on taxes alone. I had a friend whose mom had a house in Upper Montclair.
Okay.
She got older, retired, fixed income.
Right.
He's now the son. He works for, he's a journalist. His mom, she had that house since 1965. She lost the house, I think, in 2005 just because she couldn't pay the taxes. That's an issue.
Okay.
So these are some of the ways we're going to fix these issues. And it's not rocket science. It's called greed. The duopoly wants to be greedy. These people want to feed and make sure that, you know, they're good. I produced a documentary called Soul Food Junkies, and one of the characters in there said, you know who they is. It's a problem.
Okay, so how are we going to create more jobs in the state?
Well, we're going to create more jobs in the state when we are able to let people, like small businesses, most of our economy comes from small business owners. Mm-hmm. And I don't mean like somebody like myself that's a, you know, sole proprietor with one worker. I'm saying, you know, $5 million, you know.
Right.
When we are able to let them know, hey, guys, you don't have to worry about paying health care anymore. They're going to be more generous to hire more people, because even though small business owners, they want to make you work part-time, and when you get past a certain number of hours, you can't get more hours. Like, it's going to make it work. When people who own small businesses can keep and retain employees, when you've got part-timers, you've got a revolving door of people. Right. They never learn your business. You don't get good customer service. You can't provide good customer service, and you lose business. And many businesses close because of those small things that really are big things. So that would be just a natural progression to what can make the small business owner offer this to individuals.
Right.
That's what's going to grow the economy, making sure small businesses are great.
Okay. Now, just moving on.
Yes.
We have a lot of things to cover in a short period of time.
Yes.
And we're covering them. But I think one of the things that a lot of people always ask, they ask me, is that, you know, they've worked for a long time, whether they police, fire, mm-hmm. teachers, mm-hmm. You know, basically state workers. They have pensions that they mm-hmm. work for.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, people are concerned about their pensions being there when they retire. How can we make sure that the pension system is being adequately funded in the years to come?
Mm-hmm. Well, again, not to sound like a broken record, the pensions are going broke for many reasons. Of course, sometimes it's theft by the unions. Let's be real clear. All unions are not doing their job properly. You know, the idea of a union was good, but sometimes greed screws that up. But also, too, back to small businesses. If small businesses were able to thrive, then their pensions wouldn't go broke, because the business is going broke.
Mm-hmm.
If your business is broke, so is your pension. So the more we can make sure that businesses thrive and make more money, then they can make sure that pension is maintained. You have to make sure the small businesses are good. Small business is what makes America great. That's what makes America great, making sure they're strong. And so all of these things called health care, raising the minimum wage can work. Because think about minimum wage. When you now make a good living, you can now partake in going to the movie theater, patronizing the small business. It's a big circle. You can't tell me patronize a small businessman when I ain't got no money. I did my own hair today, although I look cute. But, I mean, I can't afford to go to the local salon. Don't I look cute? Like, exactly. Right? So when that's how you make the economy healthy again.
No, it's good.
You know, it's all a circle.
It is good. And also getting from your job.
Yes.
Or from your house, it's very important to be able to travel on a road that where you don't break down, right? So the Transportation Trust Fund, no money. Roads don't look good in the state of New Jersey. Plain and simple. Bridges are, you know, they need to be rebuilt. So how are we going to get money to fix the roads, fix the bridges, make sure people can travel mm-hmm. safely throughout
mm-hmm,
the state?
Mm-hmm. So once again, the more money that you can keep in the coffers of the municipalities that run, like in Newark, you know, the county takes care of the roads. So if the county didn't have that gigantic bill called health care, that would be how they can disperse that money in the budget. And also those other things like keeping people in your state, right? Working here. I worked for many years in New York. I could not afford to just be here making minimum wage and some petty cash. So if you keep people in jobs here because small businesses are hiring them, they won't be A, moving out of the state, A, or B, leaving the state and taking that dollar to New York. A lot of us work in New York. So when I worked in New York, I just stopped working in New York in December of 2016. It's just really September of 2017. When I'm in New York, I eat there, I patronize that small business, I shop a little bit there, everything's going there. So let's look at the numbers of people who literally live here who work in New York. Keep those individuals here, and that's how you change the economy. And by the way, let's legalize marijuana. Can we talk about the weed?
Let's talk about that. Should we legalize marijuana for recreational use as well as medicinal use?
Well, in New Jersey, medicinal marijuana is legalized in the state of New Jersey. So it's interesting. You know, the big boys get to sell weed legally, but the local yokel drug dealer gets locked up for it. It's usually a person of color.
Right.
So why don't we decriminalize this whole thing and just legalize it. Legalize marijuana for recreational use, and now I don't smoke weed, but I'll open up a dispensary. Y'all come on in and buy your nickel bag, your dime bag. I don't know what form it'll be sold.
Right.
But, you know, buy your nickel bag, your dime bag. Have a good time getting high. Because at the end of the day, this is what would also feed the economy. Do you realize how much money these pharmaceutical companies are making on medicinal marijuana? Do you realize if we legalized it, how big the economy would grow in the state of New Jersey? Let's just get some weed out here and let folks smoke weed. Now, here's the thing. Just like alcohol, there was a time when we had prohibition, the alcohol was illegal. They made it legal. We have liquor stores wherever. Right. Now, you have to monitor what you're doing. If you become an addict, you need not drink alcohol. Now, you have to know if this is just recreational or if you're just an addicted. So we have to leave it up to adults to make those decisions. And of course, we want to put an age thing on there, like 21 or something like that. And then we just do it like people do alcohol. Same difference.
Okay.
Yeah.
Now, gun ownership. It's a big topic these days, right?
You hit me hard.
Right. So the question is, right now, we have a lot of individuals concerned about that, a lot of safety issues.
Yes.
I'm coming from education myself, right?
Yep.
So would you mandate that there should be a mandatory safety course for gun ownership?
I'm open to it. So I am a politician that doesn't say I have all the answers, but I'm open to that. I'm open to talking about, because let me just say this right away. I was Democrat for, 53 years. Well, not 53 years, from 18 to 53. So I'm okay with the, Second Amendment, right to, bear arms, although I'm not a Republican, but I do believe in gun controls of some kind. This is a great idea to maybe do some kind of classes to when you're getting a license. When I bought my house, the bank gave me a discount on my closing fees if I took a course on how to deal with homeownership.
Right.
It was a one-day course. I got a certificate. So I'm not against that kind of thing. I'd be open to those kinds of conversations. But I want to say that I do agree with the right to bear arms. Because think about most of these killings that are happening. Yes, some of them are happening, mistakes in the home, children getting a hold of guns. But a lot of the criminal activities happening with people who are getting guns illegally. And that won't necessarily cure that.
Right. We have a lot of issues in education.
Yes.
Especially education funding for districts, whether it be urban districts or suburban districts. Some other candidates have talked about there should be one flat state aid to every district, regardless of who you're serving. I just wanted to know, as you said, when you're elected, right? When Seth and you're elected and the Green Party gets elected, what would be your education policy as far as funding to school districts in New Jersey?
Okay, we're grappling with that now because education is that real delicate balance.
It's a big issue.
It's a big issue. But so I'll throw a couple of things out there. We're grappling with it. So we're still, when you look on our website, www.kaperdaleforgovernor.com, you'll see a bit of it in the policy. We're still morphing it. At the end of the day, I can't speak for Seth. If you interview in that segment, he can tell you. I live in Newark. And we don't have local control. I think Newark has been trying, not Newark, but whoever they are pushing charter schools. I'm not against choice, but I'm not against taking away the opposite choice called traditional public schools. So I would be open to seeing how we can morph and make the balance of the two. But overall in the state, I do feel like we want to make sure that education's first. So I'm going to say for myself as the lieutenant governor, I would want to be on the front lines of finding something that's going to be palatable for everyone's children in the state of New Jersey. So I would be open to maybe some kind of a think tank or putting together some kind of thing where we listen to parents, appointing some folks, something like that so we can kind of make sure we hear everyone and then do it. Because listen, I'm single. I have no kids. When I go into the old folks' home and you change my diaper and give me my medication, I want you to be able to read and comprehend. Medicine with food or without, I need you to do it right.
Right.
So education is important. So I'll say that much.
Now for young adults, public service used to be a calling for young adults.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
And somewhere along the line, I think people got fed up with the political system and the way it's currently being run.
Mm-hmm.
So how would the Green Party look to make sure that public service is a noble calling again and make public service a calling for young adults and get more young adults into, the public service arena?
Yes, actually it's happening right now. The Green Party is that place that's been going on since the 80s that for some reason, because of the social justice angle, it attracts young people. I mean, I'm not young, 53, but whenever I go out canvassing,
the bar is raised.
I know, black don't crack. but when I'm new to the party.
Yeah.
So as I'm going out canvassing, I'm seeing all these young folks, and you should see our pages. When you go to Kaper-Dale for Governor on Facebook, right. And you go to Lisa R. Durden on Facebook,
okay.
You'll see like so many young people excited about that and they want to help out. Yeah. They're attracted to it. Why? Because we're speaking the language called the last or first social justice. And most of these things we're discussing are social justice issues. It's not about, you know, education and taxes. It's the justice of it. It's the right. It's the injustices of it. Not okay. The fact itself. We get that part. So there are injustices around fairness in all of those areas, in education, and even like, you know, incarcerating more people of color. Everything we discussed has an injustice element to it. We want justice in all those areas. Housing, we want justice in those areas.
Okay.
Not just good housing, but the justice of that. So this is what is attracting them, and we want to be able to grow up more in people like you who are letting them see us on platforms and not keeping us in a closet like we killed their mama, is going to be what makes them see it and latch on more.
Okay.
Because we're speaking their language, the last or first.
Okay. We're running short on time, Lisa, but
yes.
before we wrap up, anything that I missed that you want to talk about and, you know, basically talk to our viewers as we get closer to the election, mm-hmm. We're just a couple of weeks away,
mm-hmm.
And why basically there's a Democratic candidate, there's a Republican candidate, but there's also the Green Party candidates too, as well as
independent. I'm green, but I'm black, but I'm green.
So the question is, basically, yep. Is there anything else that you want to tell us about the Green Party and mm-hmm. if elected, what the Green Party administration would do?
Well, I think we talked enough about, you know, with this segment about where the Green Party stands. You can go on our website, www.kaperdaleforgovernor.com, and see more policies. But November 7th, people want to know when it's election day. November 7th is election day. I'm going to touch on something people don't want to discuss sure. when they're politicians. A lot of folks are wondering, are you going to win? And a lot of people are still in that mindset. A vote for you is a vote for the Republican because we're wasting our vote. When you voted for, let's say, Hillary Clinton, and she didn't win, was your vote wasted? I did a poll on my own poll because they're not even putting it in the polls.
Right.
Most said no. I voted for who I wanted to vote for. So don't vote because you think that they can win, so you will waste the vote. Vote for the party or the person or the people who you feel meets your needs. And that would be, for most of us, the Green Party. Not all. 61% of the people who were registered to vote in the last gubernatorial election
right.
didn't vote at all. We want to encourage those 61%. Here we are. Vote for us. And then we win.
Right.
And the other folks can glom onto that too. So that's what we're encouraging you. And I'm that kind of person. Don't vote for me because I'm asking. Do your research, like watching this show. Dig around. Look around. Look at how long I've been on this social justice tip for about 15 years. I'm not just here that's going to appear during the election and then right. disappear.
Right.
I've been on this game a long time as a leader. So okay. just vote for us because you really feel like we can help you. If you don't want to, that's your right as well. I'm not dogmatic about, you know, voting other than it's your right.
Well, Lisa Durden, thank you very much.
Oh, you're welcome.
I wish you well in your bid to get elected.
Me too.
this November. And
thank you.
Hopefully everybody out there will watch and make sure you vote on November 7th as we have a very important vote for governor. And that's our show for tonight. I'm Lew Goldstein. Thank you for watching Open Source. And we'll have another show next week. Until that time, stay healthy, stay focused, stay active, and I'll see you next week. Have a good night.